of the Technion, Professor Peretz Lavi. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And looking at you, I know that all of you would prefer to have a nap right now, siesta, and we are grateful that you are here. What we would like to do today is to expose to you three areas of research and applied research, areas that are very exciting and are very different from each other. And in order to start, I would like each one of the participants to introduce himself, where he comes from, what he's doing shortly, and then we will start the panel. Imad, you'll be the first.
Thank you. My name is Imad Younes. I'm the president of a medical device company. We are involved in the treatment of neurological disorders by implanting an electrode in the brain. This electrode is implanted in a certain area in the brain, and it gives...
Let's keep the story okay. For later. Where do you come from? Where did you study?
Okay,
are you married? Do you have children?
So I come from Nazareth. I was born and raised and studied also my high school and in Nazareth. Then I went to the Technion, the best, the MIT of Israel, the best technology and engineering school in Israel. I studied electrical engineering. There I met my wife, and we're married for more than 27 years, and we have three children.
Thank you, Imad. Chaim?
My name is Chaim Rabinovich. I'm coming from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. I'm a retired professor in agriculture, married, three children, nine grandchildren, and one on the way.
Alon.
I'm Alon Wolf. I'm a Technion graduate, and as my colleague here, I also met my wife at the Technion, so good things do happen at the Technion, not just professionally.
Thank you.
Also have three children, but both two of the boys were born actually in the Technion, and the little girl was born in Pittsburgh during our stay there. So yeah, we have a lot of in commons, I guess.
Well, I'll tell you a joke about couples married in the Technion at the end of the panel, so you won't run away. Let me start with you, Professor Rabinovich. I guess that every one of you who ate a tomato this morning, the tomato that you ate had something to do with Professor Rabinovich. And let me quote you on one of the interviews you gave. There was an interviewer sitting with a computer, and you told him, there is more secrets in this tomato than in your computer. Can you tell
That's
us?
Correct. That's correct.
Can you tell us a little bit about Mr. Tomato, about the tomatoes that you developed?
Well, I'll tell you later, a little bit later about the tomatoes. I'll start with a quotation by Winston Churchill that said that I always avoid prophesizing beforehand because it is much better to prophesy after the event has already been happened. So, and you asked us to tell what's going to happen tomorrow. I would like to start by what's happening today. And I assume that motorized transportation is extremely important, that cell phones are a must, that medicine is crucial for our health. And yet, survival depends on a continuous supply of food and water. And agriculture is a very, very low tech. So I feel myself as a black sheep in this crowd, yet I'll try to tell you what we're doing there.
Not a black sheep, a red sheep.
A red sheep, okay. That's also rare, isn't it? when we think about innovative agriculture, the first thing that comes to mind is drip irrigation. And I try to quote from Wikipedia, modern drip irrigation has arguably become the world's most valuable innovation in agriculture, since the invention of the impact sprinkler irrigation in 1930, which offered the first practical alternative to surface irrigation. When we examine it thoroughly, we see that we're talking about perforated polytube, valves, and some emitting devices. And this is drip irrigation, which revolutionized the world. And yet, I think that this is low-tech and not exactly high-tech. What we witness today is that agriculture supplies today all the needs of all human beings worldwide in food and everything they need. And yet, at this very moment, there are about 900 million people that suffer starvation and malnutrition. And by the end of this session, 4,000 of them will be dead, out of which 700 will be children below the age of 5. Why is this happening? This is happening because of government, it's happening because of soil erosion, of global warming, and many other things, which I'm not going to indulge in. But the consequences of what we see here is what's happening right at these days, is the migration of nations. The colossal movement of millions of people from one place to another started with a shortage of food. Think about 2008 to 2012, when there was a terrible increase in food prices and shortages. What we will try to do in agriculture is to supply the food people need, and I doubt if by 2050 there will be enough food for everyone. What we do in agriculture, we try to make functional foods, food that provides us the needs for better health, for better quality of life. What we try to do in agriculture is sustainability, getting rid of recycled water, otherwise going to underground water. What we try to do in agriculture is integral pest management, which means reducing the amount of chemicals used in order to provide us with better food. What we try to do in agriculture is to provide us all with a better world. And now I'll let you tell you a little bit about what we did with tomatoes. In the very 60s, in the early 60s, there was a report in the literature that a mutation occurred in Canada. A plant, tomato plant, that was grown there in a field, developed fruits that never turned red. Now this was a curiosity, but the farmer was smart enough to call upon the local researcher in the next research station. They came, they picked the fruit, they extracted the seed, they studied the genetics, and reported on the first known gene for halting the ripening of fruit. So this was a curiosity, only it happened again a few years later in California, and we learned again about it, and then we asked ourselves the question whether we can use it in order to extend the shelf life of the tomato. Tomato, normal shelf life is 2 to 3 days, which means in a country like Israel, if a farmer picks a tomato today, it will be softened within 2-3 days. If it happens in Florida, until it reaches Chicago, probably tomato will be very soft and people won't be able to.
Can I ask you a question? How many genes a tomato have? The number?
It's about 25 to 30,000 genes like humans.
Like humans.
But we're talking about a single gene in this case that inhibits the ripening of the tomato.
One out of 20,000 genes?
25, yes.
25.
And this gene was investigated heavily, and it was declared and was announced that this gene is recessive, which means you cannot use it in practical breeding. Only we believe that when somebody tells you that something is impossible, that life becomes interest. And together with my mentor and partner, Professor Nahum Kedar, we worked a couple of years in order to find out a genetic combination that will allow to use these genes to slow down ripening and yet having ripened fruit. This happened in 1973. And then the rest is history, because it changed the face of the tomato industry worldwide. This allowed us also to develop cherry tomatoes that at the time was a curiosity in backyard gardens, because it softened the day it was ripened. And then the next step was, since we were able to extend the shelf life of the tomato, we said picking a cherry tomato takes a lot of work. If a worker, a trained worker, picks a tomato, a regular tomato, like 800 kilograms per day, cherry tomatoes is 60 kilograms per day, and labor is very expensive. Then we said, when you buy grapes, what actually you do? You sell people a bunch and make the people agricultural workers. Why can't we do bunch tomatoes? And that's what we did, and cluster tomatoes start from.
So the next one will be square tomatoes?
That's easy. That's too easy to do. The next one will be high nutritional value tomato. I, between me and myself, call it ACE tomato, A, C, and E vitamins. And it will replace Centrum to some extent.
Thank you. Imad, when I consulted Professor Google and I typed Imad Yunus and brain, I got 60,000 mentioning. 60,000. What is your relationship to the brain?
Well, I, after graduating from the Technion,
of course,
I looked for a job, and no one accepted me but the Technion in the medical school.
And yeah, which I happen to be the dean, so.
Yes. So I worked for the Technion for a long time, for something like 7-8 years. And I worked with neuroscientists. And as an electrical engineer, this is where I started my encounter with the brain. So.
And now you have Alpha Omega.
Yes.
Which is a company that specialized in both recording from the brain and stimulating the brain. Can you explain what you are doing?
Right. So today we are involved in the treatment of neurological disorders. As we know, like the brain, if you look at the brain has a bunch of neurons that each neuron sits there and does nothing. From time to time, it sends a pulse, an electrical pulse. So, and many neurons do the same thing, and sometimes they do something. So when I move my hand, there are a bunch of neurons that send some electrical pulses to my muscles, and I move my hand, and gives me the ability to speak and to tell you what I'm thinking about. So all these electrical pulses do all that. And so to record neural activity is to see what's going on with the brain. And to stimulate the brain is to affect the brain, to speak with the brain with its language, which is the electrical pulses. So,
what kind of a disorder is treated by stimulating the brain?
There's several disorders that are treated with electrical pulses. The main disorder is Parkinson's. So there's an electrode that we implanted, a small electrode that we implanted in the brain in a certain area, and this electrode stimulates a certain area which, as a result of the stimulation, it takes care of the symptoms of the disease. There are other disorders like essential tremor.
So the patient activates this stimulation by himself?
No, it's today's technology is that the stimulation is activated all the time,
all the
24
time.
Hours a day. So we are still in the beginning of a big process that started in the early 90s, which we know today that we can treat these disorders.
How many patients worldwide are treated by such a technology?
Worldwide, there's about 150,000 patients going with such implanted device.
And you produce it in Nazareth?
No, we put in Nazareth, what we do, we're not the producers of these implanted devices. We are the producers of the navigation system.
The GPS of the brain.
The GPS of the brain. And so for some time now, we have been developing and selling these equipment, these GPS devices to hospitals, to neurosurgeons, so that they can bring this the electrode to the exact spot where the implantation should take place.
In the basal ganglia.
In the basal ganglia in this case, yes. Yeah.
Thank you. We'll continue later alone. When I consulted again, Professor Google, the best combination with your name was snake robot. What is a snake robot and why it is associated with your name?
Well, a snake, well, just imagine a snake, a real snake in nature, and now take this creature and try to build it from technology, from wires and motors and links. And so this is what we do. The motivation to develop snake robots actually came after the terror attacks in 9/11. This was the first time ever that robots were sent into the collapsed building to try to bring information, whether there are people trapped inside or whether it's safe to get into the building. The robots that were used were just typical police robots or military robots, which turns out to be big and bulky and not suitable for a place which is, it's like a chaos. Everything is upside down. So there was a challenge to try and think about a new concept. So we had to think outside of the box or outside of the brain, maybe. And then we imagine snakes in nature. They can crawl, ease themselves into holes and collapse rubbles without disrupting the environment. And we then brought snakes to the lab. We have a, as you know, Peretz, we have a gate lab, so we track their motion, we study their locomotion, we try to mathematically model their motion, and then we build robots that move just like snakes. And these robots are then sent into buildings to try to help search and rescue platoons.
When did you start research on robotics?
I started during my PhD, actually, master's degree, I guess. I got my bachelor, master's, and PhD at the Technion. But the main step was during my PhD work in 1997 with Moshe Shoah, Professor Shoah. We worked on a small robot for spine surgery, which later on became a company, a spin-off company from the Technion called Mazor. Yeah, we drove cadavers from the dissection room in Rambam to the city room in Carmel to do experiments in city rooms. And now it's a well-established company that actually save people's life all over the world. Just that you know, for spinal fusion, where you put screws in the spine, the professional literature reports 10% of misplaced screws. And for those of you who knew the anatomy, if you misplace the screw, you are in the spinal cord, which means a permanent damage. The robot is FDA approved and CE approved, and already placed close to 100,000 screws worldwide with 100% success. So about 10,000 people don't know even that they were supposed to be neurally damaged. So this was my first, take with the robotic, medical robotic field. And then, of course, the snake robot for surgery, which was an evolution of the search and rescue snake, which was big. And then we thought, if we can send a robot to buildings, why can't we send the robot into the human body, not through pipes like you do in catheterization, but intracavity space and perform surgery. So 10 years ago, colleagues of mine and myself, we were able to invent a technology that enabled to shrink the snake to 8 millimeter in diameter.
8 millimeter?
Eight, it's about the diameter of your small finger, 40 centimeter long. And we just drove the snake around the body inside. We started with heart surgery, bypass surgery, from a small approach in the subxiphoid, which means you just drive the snake around the heart while the heart is beating, do whatever you have to do, drive out, and the patient can go home the same day.
And what it is that he is doing?
The snake. The snake enables you to reach from your the entrance to a remote location in the body which is not within a line of sight, which means there is something blocking your way, so you can crawl around and reach the location, and then through the snake you operate. So this company, Med Robotics, is now located in Boston and just was awarded the FDA approval and the CE. And for the first time in history, FDA gave the company robot assisted surgery title, which was not even the Da Vinci. So Peretz, I don't know if you know, but two medical robots approved by FDA work in hospital worldwide. The second runner-up with one robot is Stanford. So Technion is the leader in medical robotic technology. Two robots in the operating room, and it's a challenge. It's a great achievement.
Thank you, Alon. Professor Rabinovich, these are three areas of research that are so far away from each other: robotics, the brain, agriculture. How do you perform an experiment in improving tomatoes? How long it take to reach from the beginning to the end? How many generations of tomatoes you wait until you say, wow, this is what I was looking for, this is the taste I was looking for in the shelf life?
Well, it takes a minimum of 6 generations, and in years' time, it's about 7 years.
7 years.
From start to end. But I wanted to say there's a common denominator here. I told you at the beginning that agriculture is a very low tech. Except for sorting and packing, all the rest is being done in a greenhouse, is being done manually. And we need badly the brain to make robots to do the picking and training and trellising and watering, everything else, to replace human work. Today it takes a lot, like 60, 70 days per 1,000 square meter in order to do harvesting all year round and treating the plants, so on and so forth. Everything, I'm sure, can be done robotically with a little bit of brain, a little bit of machinery.
Thank you. Imad, you know, I have also interest in the brain, not the awake brain, but the sleeping brain. And recording information from the brain is very important. Can you tell us a little bit about your measurements of the brain, not the stimulation of the brain, but measurements? What do you measure? What information you can extract from neurophysiological recordings?
So, like, we can divide the measurements into two or three types. So we can measure invasively. So we can insert an electrode in the brain and measure that one neuron, a
single
unit recording, single neuron. So we need for this a very tiny small electrode to do that. We can also record with a large contact what we call local field potentials. And we can record from the cortex, which is invasive also, which is called the ECOG, and we can record from the EEG, which is electrodes that are stuck on the skull, from which we can record the neural activity. Each signal, each type of signal has its own characteristics. The more we are invasive, the more we are tiny and small, the more resolution we have. The more we go out from the brain, we have more coarse measurements. So, and from with these measurements, we can do lots of things. We can measure the measure these signals to move a cursor on a screen. We can measure these signals to move a robot arm. We can measure this signal to detect the sleepness of a person, or we can
just measure. Just a second. Let me understand. You can measure the brain signal and using this signal to activate a robot arm.
Yes.
How do you do it?
As a matter of fact, it's not technology that does it. It's the brain itself.
The brain itself.
Yeah, I mean, the brain is so smart. The brain is so smart. And we humans, we say that we understand it, but we don't understand it very well. We will think we do, but like coarsely. But so what happens is that the brain learns how to send a certain signals in a way that it can move a robot arm.
There are certain diseases, for instance, ALS, the Lou Gehrig disease, in which the patient is paralyzed, except for his eyes. Can you use his brain signals, let's say, to activate the environment or to send messages?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And so we can, the technology is there. So the technology is there to do that. We don't see yet these equipment on the shelves of the pharmacies, etc., but it will happen. There are certain problems that need to be addressed. And as I said, that with non-invasive recording and few number of channels, we can do coarse movements. The more we want to do fine movements, we need more resolution. We need more resolution with number of channels and maybe to be more invasive.
Now tell me, you are a pioneer in the Arab sector, in the high-tech industry. Was it tough to open a company in Nazareth, Alpha Omega?
It's very tough, but I didn't know that in the beginning. But, you know, when I want to take this question a little bit wider, you know, the name of this session, Extreme Science. You know, to do extreme things, like to...
It was borrowed from sport, I guess.
So we have, like, I took this, there's the scientist and there's the entrepreneur. And to deal with the brain, you need to be naive, to think that you can do something. Like for a scientist to say, okay, I want to solve this problem with the brain where he doesn't understand fully what's his, so he needs to be naive to think that he can solve this problem. And then there's that entrepreneur who's so naive that he thinks that he can sell this product. So I guess to do extreme science, you need to be naive scientist or naive entrepreneur.
Otherwise it won't start.
Absolutely.
Alon, let's jump forward. The year is 2050. Would you go to the operating theater in a hospital and the nurse would say, Dr. Robot, the patient is ready for the surgery?
Actually, it's the title of a talk I gave in Rambam, Dr. Robot, the patient is sedated and ready for surgery.
But great mind thinks alike.
Going back to the tomato, it takes 6 years to develop a tomato. It takes 10 years to bring robotic technology from the lab through regulation. So 10 years.
How much of it is a regulation?
FDA is becoming much harder now, and it's about 6 years.
So let's go to 2050.
2050. So connecting to what Imad said before, so today there are many, so I give a talk often about the human-machine merger. And I at the opening of my talk, I show Steve Austin. Do you remember the Steve Austin, 1974, the bionic man?
Speaking about your tiny, minute snake robot, I would think about Raquel Welch.
Yeah.
The Fantastic Voyage.
The Fantastic Voyage, no. So today, there are robotic limbs that you can actually buy off the shelf, FDA approved, and connect them to the human body. Bionic legs, bionic arms, activated by not directly brain signals, but the muscle signals that the brain is still sending signals, and the brain is actually learning how to activate the bionic limbs. There are also bionic eyes. The first Israeli patient was just implanted about half a year ago. And of course, bionic ears with a cochlear implant. So my vision in 2050, just like dental surgery today, I spoke with dental surgeons and I got approval that today their hand is very easy on the plier to take the tooth out because they have the implants. They have a replacement, a bionic tooth, if you might say. So I think in 2050, there's a scenario like this. A patient is driven into the OR or emergency room after an accident. The doctor, the orthopedic surgeon, looks at his smashed leg and you say, why bother? Let's cut the leg and replace it with a bionic leg because it's going to serve you better. Just like dentists are replacing tooth today easily because there is something better. The technology is better.
And so, if the patient is a football player or a marathon runner, he can fit the leg to the spot.
This is a great example, Peretz, because the London Olympic was the first time ever where a paraplegic person, not talking about his personal life, I'm not talking about Oscar Pastorius, who is amputated, he was the first time ever paraplegic athlete that competed in the healthy people's Olympic. And the reason that the Olympic committee was kind of hesitated whether to approve him was not because they were afraid that he's going to hurt himself. They were afraid that it's not going to be fair. He's going to beat everyone. So in probably the Olympic Games in 2050, people are going to run 100 meter in 5 seconds or even less. So Usain Bolt is not going to be an issue
just
anymore.
Ordering a pair of legs from Amazon.
Yeah, and getting them with a drone, because the drone is going to bring the legs to you, and so jump high 20 meters, and it's everything. Steve Austin.
Yeah, thank you. Chaim, the issue of genetic engineering of food, plants, particularly in Europe, is a controversial issue. And I know that you have a very strong stand on this controversy. Do you see acceptance of genetic engineering, let's say, of plants for the benefit of mankind in 2050?
Absolutely, yes. And what I'm saying is based on discussions and meeting and talks with people from all strata of the society. The objection in Europe to GMOs is based on economic competition with the United States. Apparently, United States is like 10 generations ahead of Europe with this kind of science. And because free trade and things like that, the European, that they care a lot about the agriculture, decided to try to block it. Since they couldn't put taxes, they said, okay, there's something like intervention with the act of God, something that will interfere with the environment, something that do something wrong. We don't know yet what it will do, but it will do. So it's a mixed three things together. A, ignorance. People don't know what it is. And for an example, in Scandinavia, there was a survey among people in Scandinavia. It's not the least educated countries. There was a survey among people asking them, would you try GMOs? The overwhelming majority said no. So then we asked the people, and why do you say no? They said, when we see genes and chromosomes on TV, in the media or somewhere, they look like worms. We don't like to eat worms. This is Scandinavia. Now, you mix this ignorance with religion, intervention with the act of God, and green people that I like a lot the green, but not the ignorance attached to it, then you have a cocktail, a toxic cocktail that prevents progress in the case of, say, that today we produce medicine with GMOs. Now, I didn't hear of a single person whose son or girl were sick and they would say, oh, whoa, I won't take this medicine because it's GMO. In this case, they do. Now, the objection is slowly getting down. In Germany, it's allowed. In Spain, it's allowed. In all Eastern Europe, it's allowed. It's allowed now for animals and things like that. So I do believe that within 5 to 10 years, the entire thing will be over. But I would like to make one remark about what Alon said. It's nice to have a robotic arm, a robotic leg, and so on and so forth. I still think that people would like to have natural leg and natural hand. And by using embryonic cells, they can do it. Today, in School of Dental Medicine at the Hebrew University, after all the publicity of Technion, I must say something like that, they know how to grow cartilage cells in flasks. So what you do, a person was, his face was smashed in a car accident, they come to measure the jaws and things like that, they put some cells in the flask, and say what the date is. It's 9th of September. Okay, 21st of January, 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Are you ready? And you'll get an implant of your own cartilage without rejection, without everything. And same applies now to bones, and same applies now to skins, and same applies now to other things. So with all this magnificent progress that you're making, and I've no question that there are many cases when this is the only solution, I do believe that biology will give even a better answer.
I think the solution will be a combination of both.
Hybrids. Probably. Hybrids.
Because by the time...
I agree.
By the time that gene technology will mature, between now and then, there is robotics which is already matured and already is available, and probably the evolution of the technology will lead to a combination of, because for example, to connect those limbs, artificial limbs, directly to the brain, you do need to grow the nerve system again. So you may use the gene therapy or to grow the nerve system and connect it.
Yep. Imad, will we be able in 2050 to read the mind? You see a recording of EEG, and you say, oh, he's now thinking about a ship, a mountain, sunny morning, etc.
In 2050, it's
2050.
It's too soon.
Too soon.
Too soon. But we will be able to connect with the two,
absolutely,
like gene therapy,
tomatoes and robotics.
Yes, so it connects, and I think that like the optimal thing I would think in like for a person who has a neurological disease is to or a robot arm or what like is not that we treat him and after the treatment you can't know that this person has a certain disease. So I think this is the optimal treatment that we can strive to treat a person, and then he cannot see that he has the disorder.
Thank you. I'd like to open it now to the audience for questions. Who have a question to one of the panelists? Wake up.
Hi, this one goes for Imad. You said that we don't really know how the brain works. So what do you think we need to fully understand how the brain works?
I think we don't need to understand fully how the brain works before we do something. I think as we go, we learn, and as we go, we develop things to help people. So for example, if we take treating neurological disorders with stimulating certain areas in the brain. So today we have a stimulator that is stimulating all the time, like if it's needed or not needed. So one thing we can do is to detect the abnormality, the abnormal signals, to learn what is normal and what is abnormal for the different diseases, and give a smart stimulation. So for this, for example, we don't need to understand exactly how the brain works, but we need to understand a little bit more. This is science, this is entrepreneurship, this is like we always go step by step.
Let me add something. We take for granted that we use electroencephalograph, EEG. There is not a single neurological department without an EEG machine. The man who found or discovered the EEG was a psychiatrist who believed in parapsychology. And he tried to move objects by the power of his mind, and to prove to the world that he can do it, he put electrodes on his head. Now, to his great surprise, he found out that his head produced electrical activity. This was done in 1924 in Jena, in Germany, For 5 years, the world didn't believe him. Everybody said that these are the Berger waves, because only the brain of Berger produced these waves. Only in 1930, when Lord Adrian, who was the president of the Physiological Society in London, stood on a stage, attached electrodes to his brain, and showed that his brain too produced these waves, nobody believed Hans Berger. By the way, he became depressed and he committed suicide. So now we take it for granted. Every neurological department has an EEG machine. But for 5 years, the scientific world looked at him as a lunatic who believed that the brain emits electromagnetic waves. More questions? Here. Sorry.
Hello. I wonder if you could comment on machine learning algorithms and how you see that developing in your respective fields and pushing your respective fields forward because of that ability to analyze huge amounts of data.
Machine learning.
Machine learning. So I'll give you an example from, you know, making snake robot move, locomote. So the snakes that we develop have, they have many, many motors and links. So to coordinate them, to make a meaningful motion, takes a lot of effort. It's actually the order of the complexity of the problem is larger than the number of atoms that you can see, the combination that someone can see. It's a huge combination of steps. So what we did, one of the solutions was to model the robot in a computer and run genetic algorithms where the genes now are the motor commands, and the evolution is different motor commands to fulfill a motion that we gave. It's like an objective function, or you gave a command. Well, the objective is to move the snake from point A to point B the fastest, and what generated is a motion just like human or baby learns. Babies also, it's a reinforced learning that adapts the genetic algorithm. At the end of this process, you get a set of genes or a set of motor commands that bring the robot from point A to point B without having someone sitting there and programming it and, you know, trying to imagine how to move 20 motors in a combination that creates a meaningful motion. And it speeds up the process, by the way, by a lot. It takes about 1 million evolutions to get a meaningful motion.
Question, do you believe that by the year 2050, the machine brain will be more creative than the human brain?
The machine more creative than the human brain, Imad?
No way.
Well, in Hollywood, there is always the intuition issue. So the machines or the computers almost beat humanity, but there is the ability of humankind to improvise something, to do something outside of the if-then series of thinking.
Reaching this point violates Asimov rules of robots, so no way. Yes?
Professor Rabinowitz, maybe you can comment on the notion of artificial foods. I think Google was talking about artificial meat. Is this something that on an economic basis or on a mass production basis is something that is viable or that you think the science can achieve in the near future or in several decades?
Well, artificial food will be made out of live organisms. You cannot take iron and wood and things like that, make it a food. And it doesn't matter whether the protein comes from microorganisms, from plants, for animals, or for whatever. So when you buy a vegetative schnitzel, or you buy anything like that, it's artificial, and yet it's as nutritional as normal foods. There's no problem there. Depends what they put in. So what goes in goes out. You cannot take out something that you didn't put in.
One more.
Yeah, hi. My question is, do you think we can create
superhuman using genetic manipulations that will create a brain that is like 10,000 times smarter than the current human brain.
Super brain.
The current human brain is, you know, derived from the millions of years of evolution, and I think today we understand, you know, the genetic code. So can we use that code to create, you know, the next level superhuman?
Again, no, but like if we look at the brain, it's so smart. Like it's so smart.
But it started from one cell. The code was there.
So yeah,
if we understand the code
right.
that created okay. that brain, can we create much smarter brain?
We can create much faster machines. I mean, the brain as a machine is a very slow machine. You know, the for electrical engineers, like the clock in the brain is about 1 millisecond. Like every 1 millisecond, something happens. Like this is the resolution. In a DSP and a PC, and it's like we are talking about gigahertz. So 1 millisecond, which is 1 kilohertz, and it does so much. I can speak, I can move my arms, I can see you, I can think what I'm going to say next, and so I can do so many things in parallel.
Shortly, because...
So very short, one sentence. During years of evolution, I'm talking about 4.3 million, a billion years of evolution, somehow biological activities became perfect. Let's take a simple thing, photosynthesis. We are looking for something that is more efficient. 7,000 different plant species from all over the world were evaluated, tested, analyzed, and everything like that, and you can't find even a fraction of more efficient way to do it than plants do it today. And it all started from a single cell, as a matter of fact, of bacteria.
Hello, brain. I would like to thank the...
No, oh, I have sorry. A question. I take the privilege, you know, and I would like to ask you a question, and actually, Peretz is not asking you a question, but giving you a chance to do a shameless Zionist propaganda. Can you tell us in 2 minutes the role of the Technion in building the high-tech society in Israel, with all due respect to Hebrew University, which also played an important role? So Peretz, this is your chance to give a shameless propaganda.
Thank you very much. You honor our agreement. Well, as you know, the Technion is the first university in Israel, 8 months before the Hebrew University Chaim. And it moves from a pure engineering school to a research university that is now among the top 50 of its kind in the world. Technion graduates are the backbone of the Israeli high-tech sector. And I think that Yossi is really one of our most hilarious graduates. In the last 20 years, Technion graduates started about 2,000 companies with revenues of more than $30 billion. You'll find them in all high-tech companies. 75% of the Nasdaq related Israeli-related companies are run by our graduates. It is a nice combination of basic research that produced 3 Nobel laureates and a fourth who is a graduate of the Technion and now is in the US, so 4 Nobel Prizes, and applied research and close alliance with industry. But I always joke about couples who were married in the Technion, and we have 2 here. Alon met his wife and married in the Technion, and Imad met his wife and married in the Technion. You know, the job of the president is to raise money.
Are you doing the weddings in such situations?
So I usually meet couples who are married in the Technion, and there are 2 groups. I can divide them into 2 groups. One, the husband comes to me and whispered on my ear, "I met my wife in the Technion, you won't see a penny out of me." The second, the husband say loud and clear, "I met my wife in the Technion, I'll double my gift for next year." Thank you very much, Alon, Chaim, Imad, and thank you, Yossi.
I've been sitting here wondering, will the matchbox gonna hold my clothes? I've been sitting here wondering, will the matchbox gonna hold my clothes?